Hello. Recently, Docker Desktop announced a new version, which is the 4.23 version. This was released last week. One of the features which is added to this is the Docker Init support for ASP.NET. I've been using Docker for ASP.NET or .NET applications with .NET Core for last 7 or 8 years. I wanted to give this feature a try. Instead of handcrafting the Docker files and Docker compose files, Docker Init allows us to give some sensible defaults and create this Docker file as well as Docker compose for our application. And let's get into it and see how we can use this feature. Let's start by looking at the application. I have a very simple application here, which is built using the minimal APIs or minimal approach, which is available as part of recent .NET Core applications or .NET applications. And I have a very simple application here, which is a web application, which says Hello World. It maps the default route to Hello World. And when we run this, it will just display Hello World. If you look at the framework which it is targeting, currently it is .NET 6.0. .NET 7.0 is the latest version, but I would like to start with 6.0 and see how does the Docker Init help to create us Docker files for this. So let's head over to the terminal, and I'm currently in the same folder where this .NET Init project resides, at the same level of the hierarchy in my application where the csproj file or the project file for my .NET project resides. Now, the easiest way or the way Docker does this is we have this Docker Init command, which will give us a utility which creates these three things. It will create a Dockerignore file, which contains all the elements or all the files which should be ignored from the Docker context. It will create a Docker file for our application, and it will create a compose.yaml file. It's going to look at my project definition, and it is automatically detecting that I have an ASP.NET application. So I'm going to use this. Then it's asking me what is the name of the solution or the main project for this. It has also automatically identified that this is .NET-init in my case, and what is the version. Again, looking at the project file, it has inferred that this is 6.0. So I'm going to use 6.0 as the .NET version for this. And what is the local port that the server is going to run on? It runs an embedded server, and we require a port mapping to be done for us to access this application when it is running inside the container. I'm going to use the default recommended port 8080. And we see that it has created these four different files. One which is the .dockerignore or .dockerignore file, just like .gitignore. It will help us to ignore those files which are not required for the Docker build. Then we have the Docker file, the compose file, and the Docker readme file. Let's head over to Visual Studio Code and look at what was generated as part of this Docker Init. Let's first start by looking at the Docker file itself. It starts with a multi-stage build, which is also one of my preferred approach, where I start with a first stage, which is the build stage, and we can see that it is targeting the .NET SDK 6.0 Alpine base image. I like this part because I prefer to have my base images as very light images, and if you've seen my previous videos which I've done for containerizing .NET applications, I prefer to use the Alpine version of the .NET SDK, which is a very, very small size of the image. And that itself is a good starting point for me. Next thing is a typical thing which we do with containerizing a multi-stage Docker build, or containerizing an application using multi-stage Docker build, where we copy the source file into the container or into this base image, and we set the working directory as source. The other thing which I like is about this caching of the dependencies. I've also done a video in the past on this, where this helps us to build the cache of our dependencies that we use for our application. And this is applicable not just for .NET, for any programming language that we have, where we pull dependencies from external sources like NuGet packages or from Maven Central in case of Java, for example. We can cache them so that the container, when we build it, Docker engine doesn't have to pull these images every time or pull these dependencies every time. That is built as part of the cache. So this is the second part which I like about this auto-generated Docker file using the Docker init. The next thing we have is again the second stage or final stage of our multi-stage build, which is to copy the output of the previous command where we built the container or where we built the application and we published it. So the first part here where we use the mount cache is mounting the packages from this root.nuget packages folder, and it's also running the .NET publish command using the current profile. It's also creating this application as a self-contained, sorry, it is not creating this as a self-contained application, and the output it's writing is to slash app folder. So this will generate the output. Now when we want to run this, we don't need all the build tools, and that is where we just need the ASP.NET runtime image. It is again using 6.0 Alpine version, which is also my preferred version when I'm working with .NET Core or .NET for that matter. And then we copy the output from the previous build stage, the slash app folder, into this. The other part which I like about this auto-generated Docker file is the creation of this user which does not have a privileged user rights. It is creating a non-privileged user, and it sets these command line flags that it doesn't create a home directory, it doesn't create this sbin, and all these different parameters it is passing to create the user named as app user. And then it runs the .NET init.dll, which is our application, using the entry point instruction in the context of this user. So far what I've seen as part of this Docker init is perfectly fine. In fact, it has done a step better than what I personally do in my multi-stage Docker build. I usually don't add this non-privileged user. So far, this is one of the good things that I found, and I'm perfectly happy with what this content of the Docker file is. Next, let's look at the compose file. So this compose file is a very simple one. Again, since we are dealing with only one particular service here or one particular application, it has gone ahead and created this services section. It has created a service called as server in this context, and the target it is saying is final. It is also doing a port mapping to 8080, because the Alpine image that we are using as the base image, it's exposing port 80 and we are mapping it to port 8080 here. It also gives us a comment or a sample here in case we want to use other things like dependencies. Like for example, if we want to integrate with Postgres, it tells us how this should be integrated. And if we look at the other file, which was the Dockerignore, this is a standard Dockerignore file where it is ignoring things like the class path, .env, .git, .ignore, .project, the settings, all these files which should not be part of our Docker build context, and they should not be part of the final container image, like the readme file. We don't really need to have the readme file in our target application. So with that, we see that this particular Docker init has done a great job so far in terms of generating the Docker file, the compose file, and Dockerignore file. The last part, or the last file which was generated, is the readme.docker.md, a markdown file, which gives us an instruction on how to run this. So we can use this command now, docker compose up with the build flag, to build and run that. And it also says that the application would be available on localhost 8080. So let's go and try that. Let's clear the screen and we run this command, docker compose up --build. It's going to build that image that we are trying to build, and we can see that it is already running. It has created a network here, Docker init server 1, and the application is running. If we head over to the browser and we hit localhost on port 8080, we should see the hello world as the output. That is what our program is doing. So this is a very good way of generating the Docker file in case you are new to Docker, and in case you are building applications on ASP.NET or using ASP.NET, Docker init can help you to get bootstrapped with the required files in terms of the Docker file, the compose file, and Dockerignore. The other thing which I wanted to try as part of this is what happens if I upgrade my application framework. If I move from, let's say, my current version of .NET, which is 6.0 that I'm using, if I move to 7.0, if I upgrade the framework, what would happen? Let's go and stop this, what is running currently. And let's run Docker Init again to see what is the impact of this on our application. So it's telling us the same thing what we saw in the earlier case, that this particular utility is going to create these files, and it identifies that there is already these files are existing in the folder or the directory, and I want to override. I choose the same options, .NET, .NET init is the project, and this time we can see that it has upgraded the framework version or .NET version from 6.0 to 7.0, which is what I have upgraded in my project file as well. Let's go ahead with the same port 8080, and if we go back and look at those same files again, let's start with the Docker file. The change that we see is now it has updated the image from the base image, the SDK image, from 6.0 to 7.0 Alpine image. And same way, the final image, which is used for running the runtime version of the application, has been upgraded to 7.0. So that again is a good indication that if we upgrade our project version from a previous version of .NET to the new version and we rerun the Docker init command, it is able to upgrade the Docker files to the latest version itself. With that, let's go and make a small change to the application code itself to identify that it is picking up the changes. So I'm going to comment this initial line and just update it to say we are using a .NET 7.0 now. Now let's go back to our terminal and run the Docker compose up command with that build flag. And this time we will be referring to the 7.0 version of the Alpine image. So you can see clearly in the output here that it's using SDK 7.0 in the first stage of the build, which is our build stage. And then it's using ASP.NET 7.0 as the Alpine version as the runtime image. And since the application is still available on 8080 port, if I refresh this particular page, we see that now it is showing .NET 7.0. So with that, I can say that this particular addition of supporting ASP.NET as part of .NET or as part of the Docker init is a welcome addition. I see a lot of people benefiting from this, especially when you're new and you're trying to search for information how to create Dockerfile using best practices. I do see that it is implementing some of the best practices, and let me show you something which I use for my own projects, which I've done in the past. So this is an example of the Cloud Native Ninja series where I use a multi-stage Docker build with SDK 7.0 or .NET SDK 7.0. You can see that the steps are almost similar. 90% of the stages are similar. The only difference here is I have an additional dependency on this TechTalks model, which I add and I run this. But apart from that, all the other instructions are similar to what I did when I handcrafted this Dockerfile. So in that sense, I'm very, very happy with this support for the .NET builds or .NET files generation as part of the Docker init. And I look forward to the other languages as well. So far, if we look at the Docker init, I think there are only a few languages which are supported. Let's do Docker init once again and see which are the languages which are by default supported at this point in time as of the version of Docker desktop, which is 4.23, released on 11th of September. So we see ASP.NET, Go, Python, Node, Rust, these are supported by default. And if we don't have the direct support for the programming language, we can still start with a boilerplate, a very minimal implementation of generating these files using other as an option. But then when I gave a try for this other, it was very, very generic. And since it doesn't support a particular programming language, the information is not that really helpful in my opinion. I hope you found this useful. If you would like to see some other videos like this, please let me know in the comments what you would like me to try next. And do like the video, do subscribe to my channel. Thanks for watching. Until next time, code with passion and strive for excellence.